All right, everybody, welcome to Authentically. I'm your host, Charlie, and we have a very, very special guest today, straight up from Wisconsin. This guy hit a clutch money bucket, literally getting that cash money at the TBT, at that bubble there with hoops back in America. This guy, none other, you hear his walkout song, it's Travis Diener. Give it up. What's going on, Travis? Good, man. How are you doing today?
Doing well.
So I know you got the Jordan on. You're a hooper. It's probably in your veins, man. Let's just talk some hoops first of all, man. What gets you up in the morning to get that rock and to play ball?
You know, I've been doing it since I was, you know, a little boy, and it's just something I fell in love with at a very young age. And you know, in life, I think it's hard to find something that you truly love, and most people aren't fortunate enough to go to work, if you can even call it that. And do something they truly love. And I've found that, and I'm very blessed. And I try to appreciate, you know, each day that I get a chance to lace them up.
And you lace them up right at Marquette. You know, it's funny, I'm from Michigan. I'm a Michigander. And so I always thought, you know, growing up, that Marquette was going to be like in the UP, right? Cause in the Upper Peninsula. Do you ever get that? Like I went to the Upper Peninsula every summer with my family.
All the time. So where is Marquette? Is that Michigan?
Yeah, dude. No,
it's actually in downtown Milwaukee.
Yeah. Oh man, that's hilarious. Yeah, dude. So what was it like playing ball there? I know you hooped it up with Flash D Wade. What was it like hooping there?
Man, it was great. You know, it's 4 years that probably springboarded my future, and you know, the lessons I learned from Coach Crean and the successes and failures that, you know, we went through. Made me into a professional. So without Marquette, without Coach Crean and my teammates, you know, I'm probably not here today talking to you, and have had a, you know, a long, you know, professional career. So, you know, I had a blast. Obviously we went to the Final Four and things like that. So it was a incredible 4 years playing at Marquette.
And how was it playing with Dwyane Wade?
It was easy. Made my job easy as a point guard. You know, I've always, you know, people, I think, assumed by the last couple of years of my college career that I was a scoring point guard, but that's never how I envisioned myself. I always like to, you know, make the extra pass, be a pass first point guard. And with Dwyane, it was easy. You know, just, you know, he could run the floor. He was incredible in transition. So, I think he made our jobs a lot easier, and I tried to make his job a lot easier as well.
And then, Travis, talk about your career. I know in life there's always ups and there's always downs. Sometimes we don't realize why things are happening in the moment, but we know they're happening for a reason. I know you've had a career in the NBA, gone overseas, you know, playing in Italy. For me personally, that holds a special place in my heart, Travis. I traveled with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes there, and we did sports camp there, and we trained and served in the Alps Mountains and near Turin. There's a place called Bobbio Pollice, a valley there. Yep. And just the people there, the food, obviously. You can't beat genuine Italian food. Describe your experience and maybe the ups and downs and what you've learned from your career bouncing from place to place and now being in Italy.
Yeah, I mean, I think in sports, you learn a lot about yourself, and you know, you learn how to deal with adversity, and I think that's the greatest thing about sports, whether it's a basketball player or anything. You know, if you know, you're gonna have times where, you know, you lose a little confidence in yourself, maybe you get injured, you're not playing as well as you would like, and it's all part of, you know, the journey. And you know, for me, that was the best part about it. Obviously, going through those times is not easy, but once you, you know, see the light and you reach the, you know, you get out of that spot, you know, you appreciate what you've gone through and you find out so much about yourself. So for right. me, I mean, for me, there's been adversity all through my whole life, and not anything that was life or death, but, mm-hmm. you know, like we talk about, like, you know, there's injuries, there's the fact that I'm obviously not the biggest, strongest guy. So I always face that uphill challenge of trying to compete against guys that were, you know, a lot bigger, stronger, more athletic. So that was a something I had to deal with consistently throughout my career. Obviously moving overseas, learning a new culture, you know, there's adversity in that. So, you know, like I said, you know, dealing with that and coming out and having a long career is what I'm proud of. It's, you know, I'm proud of the fact that I can look myself in the mirror and I think I've maximized my abilities and my God-given abilities. I've maximized those to the, you know, the fullest form.
Hmm. And what do you enjoy most about ball in Italy?
You know, I think just ball, you know, as a whole, wherever it is, I think I enjoy – there's two things I enjoy the most. First, I'm extremely competitive, and I enjoy lacing them up and going toe-to-toe with another team. And you know, in sports, it's black or white. You know, you win or you lose. There's no really gray area. And I also – I love being a part of a locker room. I love, you know, coming into the locker room before and after games, whether it's a big win, a tough loss, enjoying experiences because, you know – for basketball players and most athletes, you're around people that are totally different from you. They grew up totally different. They're from different backgrounds. And the commonality of bringing people together in sports and having one true goal in mind and bringing together and just sharing those experiences is something that I truly love as well.
What an incredible example that we can apply in life too. You know, being an athlete myself, being in locker rooms, like you said, it's guys from all different backgrounds and what's going on in our climate today. We could learn a lot from sports, to be honest with you, just that if you we're all under one common goal and we unite for something, you know, we can make, you know, a positive impact in this world, man. And so do you want to talk about what your experience was like at the TBT? First of all, just first, what it was like to be in that bubble. The NBA, obviously, they're starting their season in a bubble. What that was like playing under the protocols and what you can expect with the NBA coming up.
Yeah, it was obviously it was you had to sacrifice, you know, 2 weeks being away from your families for that extended period of time during, you know, the summer, which for most, you know, basketball players, that's the off season. But then once you got there, as long as the players are committed to following the restrictions, the guidelines, it'll be successful. So in the TBT, all the players, you know, we hung out with our own teams. We didn't co-mingle. We obviously got tested 7 or 8 times while we were there. Mm-hmm. And we just followed the rules and it worked. And after, you know, after a few days, there was, you know, everybody in that bubble was negative and, you know, we got to play ball and that's what we were there for. So as long as the players in the NBA or Major League Baseball or wherever follow the guidelines that are put in place, and obviously, I think it's a lot harder for Major League Baseball because they're traveling.
Right.
But for NBA guys, and I think they've had a lot of success early on now, is once you reach a certain point, there should be no more positive tests as long as they're staying in the bubble and, you know, just going to practice, going to games. So I think you're going to see the NBA have a lot of success. I think they're going to finish the season. And, you know, that's the ultimate goal.
Absolutely. And then, you know, winning that championship, I know a few years you try to go after it. What was it like when the rock was passed to you? You spot up, shot it, went in, you won the championship, $1 million.
Yeah, I mean, like we talked about, the adversity, you know, coming so close, you know, the previous 2 years, losing in the Final Four, you know, 2 years ago, then last year losing the championship game in a close game. And then this year, you know, being in another dogfight and maybe realizing that, geez, this might happen again. But, you know, once the play was actually happening, you know, it's all muscle memory as basketball. You know, I've shot that shot, you know, tens of thousands of times. You're not thinking, you know, basketball happens so fast. You're not thinking about, you know, this shot's worth $1 million or this shot is worth a championship. You kind of just, you're in the moment, you catch, you shoot, you follow through. And, you know, afterwards, then it's, you know, then you get excited and, you know, you're happy. But, you know, during that moment, it's, you know, just pretty much muscle memory.
And then right after that, I know I was reading that you paid the bill for everyone's drinks at your dad's bar, right? And then some of the money was donated to pancreatic cancer movement. You want to talk about what you're doing with the money?
Yeah, you know, first, my parents' bar is, you know, in my hometown of Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, and it's a place that has shown me a lot of support throughout my, you know, my whole career from when I was a little kid to now. And that was just a small gesture to the people that were at the bar that night that, you know, here's a thank you, drinks on me for the night. And then the second part of that is, as a team, we decided that we're going to do another, you know, small token of appreciation to the team we beat, Sideline Cancer, who represents pancreatic cancer. Uh, they're the main person, Kathy Griffith, was, you know, her husband was, you know, diagnosed with that terrible disease and passed away. So it was kind of us saying we appreciate what they stand for. You know, they're part of the tournament just like we are, but they stand for something more than basketball. And we're just trying to, you know, pay it forward a little bit and appreciate how hard they played against us and kind of what they represent.
And I know somebody posted a reaction of your dad. I mean, just being ecstatic, seeing you hit that game-winning shot. I picture, you know, my dad being there first row. And family, you know, now being married to a wonderful wife, you know, obviously my marriage and family means so much to me. What did it mean to you for your dad to be there supporting, cheering you on, even to this day at his bar? And then what does your family mean to you in your journey of life?
Yeah, you know, my parents have, you know, set a standard of hard work and, you know, support and all that. They've done that for my 38 years of my life. They're at, you know, every game growing up. In college, they traveled to mostly every road game, you know, driving 8 to 10 hours, you know, to get to the game. And then right after that, you know, driving right home. So the support there has always been there, and it's always meant a lot to me. And, you know, you always know you have somebody in your corner, even when things aren't going well. Because, you know, as things start to get going really well, especially for professional athletes, people will pop up and their intentions are really bad. But, you know, for having my two parents and my two sisters along for the whole ride has meant the world to me. And now, you know, as I've gotten older and I've gotten married and I have three kids, you know, that's kind of – it puts everything into perspective. You know, there's more to the game – there's more to life than just basketball. You know, I come home after a game, win or lose, and I'm in a totally different mood than I would be if I didn't have kids. It's not life or death for me anymore. It's how can I be the best father? You know, how can I be a better husband? So family means the world to me. It's something that I think is, as a father, you know, you're kind of, you're put on this earth to do that. And I'm, you know, trying to be the best version of that, you know, each day.
That's awesome, man. And, you know, that's so true, because it's hard to trust everybody, but you know, you got your family that you can support and rely on. And, you know, for me, I'm just passionate about being an amazing husband, eventually an amazing father one day. And, you know, I just think that's so important to be good men in this world, to be a good husband, to be a good father. I don't think that's talked about as much, to be honest. I think that it kind of gets brushed aside. What are your thoughts on that? And, you know, just being a good family man, a good husband, a good fatherhood, especially in today's day and age.
Well, first, I think it's extremely important for, you know, obviously the development of kids. And, yes, you know, I was fortunate enough to have, you know, a father and a mother who have been there every step of the way. And unfortunately, you know, we talked about people growing up in different backgrounds and coming from all different places. And, you know, it happens that a lot of people don't grow up with, you know, both parents, right. You know, and that's hard. So I think it's very important for, you know, the next generation to be there for their kids, to be present, especially for fathers, to be there to know that their kids have someone that, you know, they can look up to, that they know right from wrong, and can just develop the right work habits to be successful in life, because, you know, life will throw a lot at you. It's not as easy as maybe one might think, and it's definitely not as hard as one might think either. So I think it goes both ways. As long as you have some values, you have some ethics, and you have people around you that, you know, have your intentions at the highest, you know, they're not going to lead you the wrong way.
And what's the biggest thing you've learned from your marriage?
Yeah, I mean, I think with marriage, you learn patience. You learn that, you know, you learn sacrifice. It's not always about you. I think naturally growing up and the humanly possible, you think of, you know, you always think of yourself first, and you got to get over that.
Right.
You know, I think in marriage, first you have to think of, you know, your spouse, and then as you have kids, you know, obviously your kids come first. So I've learned that, you know, obviously being an athlete, you kind of think of yourself, you think you're invincible, but through marriage, through fatherhood, you learn patience, you learn sacrifice, and you learn that, you know, you can't just always think about yourself and put yourself first.
Yeah, and I know that for me, firsthand, my parents were divorced, and, you know, there's a lot of broken families in our generation, and a lot of, you know, dudes out there just trying to mess around. I know for me personally, I knew that when I got married, it was going to be Christ at the center and my bride. And that was the only way it would work because, you know, for me, he's the ultimate depiction of sacrifice and love. And I'm, you know, we're selfish by nature, right? And so that's the only way I could best serve her. And so I guess what does faith mean to you, if anything, too, as well, Travis?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's hard. I mean, you see what happens in society and you see, you know, I think people take for granted the vows they take in marriage.
Yeah.
And, you know, they fit. And that's why, you know, these divorce rates are really high because maybe it's not as concrete as it should be. So I think having the values of, you know, being faithful to your wife, being, you know, and obviously if you're not faithful to your wife, then the odds are that, you know, your kids are going to grow up and not be faithful to their spouse. And that just is a cycle that is never ending. And that's not the cycle that can develop kids the right way. You know, you want your kids to grow up and see your parents as role models, as how does their mother treat their father and vice versa? How does the father treat your mother? How do you treat your siblings? So I think it's a cycle anyway, good or bad. You know, I think, you know, if you go back and you look at all these, you know, success stories and how people grew up and were they surrounded by love and, you know, passion and, you know, things of that sort, then they're going to grow up that way. I think you're a product of your environment. And yes. Unfortunately, you know, a lot of people, and I wasn't one of them, but people grow up behind the eight ball and they're always fighting that uphill battle, but they have to find a way out. They have to find people that truly believe in them. And maybe that isn't their mother or father. Maybe it's their grandmother, their aunt, a best friend, a best friend's mom or dad. But it's important that someone, you know, can find these kids and help them in any way possible so that, you know, when they are young adults, they can be successful and find a marriage and find a wife and, you know, and find kids.
Absolutely. I know even though my parents were divorced, you know, they still set a strong example. Like they were there for me and you have encouraged me my whole life. And for them, their faith in Christ was a beautiful example for me. And I know it starts with us as men. I've realized I've been married over 2 years and obviously it's not perfect, but it starts with the men to set the tone. Am I going to walk home from work in a sour mood? Am I going to serve my wife? Am I going to take out the trash? Am I going to, you know, do things that I wouldn't normally enjoy doing, but to show my love for her. And so I think that's awesome. I just want to keep encouraging you publicly, encourage you to just keep it up, man. Cause I know as dudes, like it can get hard out there. So just keep it up because I'm also striving to be a faithful, loving husband. And I think that's so true. It starts at the core of the family and changing society and having strong families that, that love each other, man. So I appreciate you saying all that, Travis. And so now we're going to get into just a fun segment I do at the end of these podcasts. It's called Are You For Real? So there's four questions. Are you ready? It's a fascinating segment.
I'm ready.
Okay. This is the segment, Are You For Real? Question number one. I know you bought drinks for basically all of Wisconsin, Travis, just your dad's bar after the TBT win. But if you were to get a drink with anybody in this world, past, present, or future, who would it be with and what would you guys be drinking?
Wow. you know, since I'm a basketball player, I'll go with Michael Jordan. Mm. He's the GOAT in my eyes. And he's
on your shirt.
Exactly. He's fascinating. You know, watching The Last Dance, he's fascinating to just listen to his personality. He would be having tequila. I know he's a big tequila drinker. Yeah. I would probably be having a glass of red wine.
Red wine, okay.
And we both would be smoking a cigar.
Nice. A championship, one of his championship cigars, eh?
Yeah, for sure. One of his championship cigars.
Right. What kind of red wine?
Probably a cab.
A cab, okay.
Nice
okay.
cab, yeah.
He'd probably have his $1,000 tequila, whatever he was drinking in The Last Dance, too. That kept
exactly
getting sick.
For sure he would.
Sweet. So question number two, are you for real? What is the best fries, hands down?
The best fries?
Yeah. Do you eat fries?
French fries?
French fries, yeah.
Jeez.
that's the million-dollar question.
Like a specific place?
Yeah, fast food, you get it from the freezer section, the grocery store. I know America loves our French fries, so.
Absolutely. Man, I don't know. That's hard.
I know, because there's so many good ones. I mean, you got In-N-Out. You got McDonald's, obviously. Those are
I'm actually going to go with – this is pathetic, but I would – if right off the top of my head without really thinking, it would be McDonald's. Yeah. I think that's sad.
I mean, that's just –
I mean, I've had a lot of great fries. I just don't know remember exactly. I mean, the restaurant, you know, they season them really well.
Yeah.
If off the top of my head, yeah. McDonald's, but I mean, obviously they have to be fresh.
I think that's a product, of course, yeah, because, you know, there's people who don't do it fresh, but I think that's a product of being a Midwesterner, too, because I remember when I started out my career, I was working in middle of nowhere, Michigan, and all we had, like, I love coffee, right, and all we had was McDonald's within an hour, so it was a rural area, so I got my coffee from McDonald's. If I want a good, you know, good fries, get it from McDonald's, so
there you
I think
go.
I think it's just a product of being a Midwesterner, man.
Maybe, I need to... I've never been asked that question. So now every time I eat a fry, I'm going to keep notes.
You got to represent. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Question number three. Are you for real? What are you most passionate about in life?
Well, that one's easy. That's my kids. You know, you find that everything else is kind of minute compared to what they're going through. And you know, the joy and innocence that they have right now is special. You wish they could have that forever. You know, you come home from work and they're so excited to see you. And you try to appreciate those days. And because I know they won't last forever, because I know how I was as a kid. And I for sure wasn't that excited to see my parents every time I came home that I can remember. Obviously, they're still very young. But, you know, I'm very passionate about, you know, making them respectful and good human beings and hopefully be successful in whatever they choose to do when they get older.
Nice. That's awesome. And what's your kids' names? How many kids do you have again?
Three. Karina is 8, Mila's 6, and Luca's 3.
Are those good ages? You're enjoying that?
I am. Yeah. I think anywhere from, you know, my oldest daughter is getting a little sassiness to her, but it's a good age. There, my little boy turned 3, you know, 5-6 months ago, so now he's becoming his own little kid, and that's always a special age as well.
Nice. That's awesome, Travis. All right, so number 4, are you for real? If there was a movie to be produced, shot after your life, Travis, who would you have playing you, and what would the movie title be called?
I don't know the name of the movie. I'd probably have like, I'm going to say Mark Wahlberg.
Hey, there you go.
Seems like a decent athlete. has some,
yes.
It's funny, but it's serious. And I think the movie would kind of portray that. It'd be kind of a half comedic drama, so to speak. So. I don't know the name of it. I'd have to think of that, but I'll go with Marky Mark.
Marky Mark, nice. Say hello to your mother for me. I roll with Mark and Denzel, man. Those are two of my favorite.
Yeah,
actors.
Denzel's great. He's one of my favorites as well, but I'll go Marky Mark as more of you know, some comedy in there. Denzel always plays that very very funny but very serious funny.
Yeah. That's awesome. Well, thank you so much for being a guest of Authentically Travis. Appreciate you, man. And anything else you'd like to add?
No, just appreciate you having me.
Of course, man. Close it out. Do you mind if I just pray for you and your family?
Likewise.
Lord, I just pray for Travis. Continue to bless his wife and his marriage and his family and his kids. Just continue to, you know, help them to grow up, to show them love, what true love is, and continue to be with Travis and his career, his hooping career, being a father and a husband, and bless them and show them your love, Jesus. In your name, amen.
Amen.
All right, Travis, keep singing those buckets, dude.
All right, man, appreciate having me.
All right, have a good day, man.
All right, later, man.
Later. I have guests on this podcast, man. I just ask each guest if you had a walkout song. Like if you were playing baseball and you could walk out to any song to get hype, or for your instance, when you step on the court, what would it be?
All There by Young Jeezy.
Okay, you got some Jeezy out there. Why that song? Oh,
You know, I just like the beat. I think it just gets me in a good mind frame, puts me in the right spot, hypes me up. I love Jesus, though.
Classic.